It's that day of the week again when we explore and appreciate green ideas and inventions. This is Going Green. The Supreme Court is conducting hearings on genetically modified organisms and their potential risks to human health and the environment. Petitioners say GMOs are unsafe to be planted, processed, and eaten. Now, here to tell us more about this is Dr. Tushar Chakraborty. He's the principal scientist of the Gene Regulation Laboratory at the Indian Institute of Chemical Biology. Good morning, Doctor.
Good morning.
Okay, we were having a fantastic chat already about the subject, but really, for people out there who may not be too familiar with some of the terms here, when we say GMO or genetically modified organism, what exactly are we talking about?
Okay, so these are organisms in which normal organisms in which you have introduced a segment of genes which are laboratory made through a technology we call recombinant DNA technology.
Okay, so basically we're rearranging the DNA.
Yes, yes. And I would say one thing, this acronym GMO for genetically modified organism is a misnomer.
Okay.
So actually it purposefully tries to blur the distinction between the normal breeding and these artificial organisms. These organisms has a built-in instability, because in these organisms one part, the vast majority of the genes are normal, but you have superimposed a very minor part and make it dominant for a purpose. So there is a contradiction between the normal host organism, its gene, and this part. So these are very unstable and imprecisely made organisms, laboratory made, and that was why the risk with these GMOs comes when they are in open environment.
Okay.
When they are used in a factory, in a confined environment, in experimentation, laboratory experimentation, in a bioreactor, so no problem. And we are getting human insulin through these bugs and lot of other products, enzymes, no problem with that. But when you are throwing this unstable, imprecise organisms into open environment, problem comes, and GMO, this genetically modified organism, genetic modification is a very soft term. So everybody is genetically modified.
Right.
So every son or daughter with a father, so they are genetically modified form of their progeny.
Right.
So that's a misnomer, scientifically speaking.
Okay, but I mean, on paper, this was the idea was to try and improve crops, make them resistant to disease, make them resistant to pests rather. You know, great ideas, I think, but there are some significant downsides, and the people who don't believe in this process have a lot to say on this. What, in your opinion, really are the dangers that we're looking at here?
Right. So the intended purpose is obviously good. So no scientist, not scientific community will not enter into this business, into the development of these things, if the intended purpose is bad.
Right.
So intended purpose is good, but there are unintended consequences.
Right.
Through which, for which you had to be an ecologist, you had to be a social scientist, so you have to be an environmental scientist to really look into its unintended consequences.
Right.
And those risks are not encountered, so people who have developed them, these recombinant DNA technology, I am a geneticist myself, so we usually don't know this because we are very highly compartmentalized expert, and that is where it comes. And the problem is three major problems.
Right.
One is potential human health risk when you consume these foods. The second is the ecological environmental risk. So that is the second major risk. So it can cause ecological catastrophe, in a sense. And the third risk is consolidation of corporate in the food chain, which is going to increase the price, reduce biodiversity, reduce our food plate. So that is the corporate consolidation instead of the farmers' right over the with the agriculture.
Right. I like where you're going with this discussion. You're really saying let's take a look at the big picture here.
Big picture.
I mean, if all we're looking at really is, you know, a scientist saying I'm going to insert a gene here and make it pest proof. We've done that. It's now pest proof. Perfect. I get a medal for that. But What happens there? Let's take a look at what happens in the long term, in the bigger picture. If you make, in this particular case, where right now we're discussing whether or not we should be planting BT talong or BT mm-hmm. eggplant.
Yes, yes.
And we're challenging that really because let's take a case here. If, for example, we planted BT eggplant in the open, in an open field, there are some, like you said, consequences that have to be taken into consideration here. Yes, you've got a eggplant which is pest resistant, but you were saying it comes with certain conditions. A certain amount of your field has to be used for planting non-BT varieties mm-hmm. to act as quote-unquote a refuge. Really for the pests which will not be eating the mm-hmm. plants. Mm-hmm. We don't know what happens. The BT toxin actually goes into the entire plant, not just the fruit itself.
Yes.
It goes into the leaves. It goes into the roots. There are animals that eat mm-hmm. the roots, that eat the leaves, not necessarily affecting the fruit which goes mm-hmm. to the market.
Yes.
And there are studies which show that over the long term, mm-hmm. there are some health consequences to consuming the BT toxin.
Yes.
Because it's a fact that GMO has been around for quite a number of years.
Yes. Two decades.
Two decades.
In US.
Yeah, in the US. But fact is, there's no actual long-term human consumption, really. We're talking about industries like cotton, maybe. Industries where crops are grown for use in biofuels and such. So the biggest concerns really here are, enlighten me here, doctor, health concerns, obviously, to humans over the
potential
long term. What sort of health concerns are we looking at here?
So we are looking at, so we are going to directly eat those, and the amount will be, so you cannot wash off these toxins from the plant.
So it's,
you can wash off the pesticide at least.
So it's agreed that, well, pesticides as we use them now are no good for us.
No good for us.
But your point is at least it's on the outside.
Yeah, at least it's on the outside. But you cannot wash off this toxin from mm-hmm. your food.
Okay.
And so eventually you will be eating, mm-hmm. if you accept this technology, you will be eating a lot of it.
Okay.
The limited animal study, so industry has not done any good long-term studies mm-hmm. on any animal even, but people who have studied it have already shown in mouse and rat that it is causing a hepatic problem, kidney problem, mm-hmm. and inflammation of the bowel mm-hmm. and the intestine mm-hmm. and even cancer. So all these problems are coming and with the long term.
Why do you think we don't see this in countries, although we've pinpointed the fact that there's no real human ingestion, direct ingestion.
Yes. Or human trial
at this point, despite the fact that the GMOs have been in use in other countries, particularly the US, for quite a while now.
Yeah.
But we don't have any real data of what it's doing to humans long term.
Yeah. What it can do mm-hmm. to human. There is mm-hmm. no systematic study mm-hmm. From them. The studies on animal, mm-hmm. which companies have did, people have relooked even those data and found their own study are showing effect, uh-huh. which they're not reporting.
Okay.
So even the company's own safety reports, when were scrutinized by independent scientists, mm-hmm. they found actually they have shown the effect, reduction of the growth and some of the other effect, mm-hmm. even in the short-term exposure, which they have not reported.
Right.
Okay. They have looked at the other side, other issues, not these issues.
Okay.
So already they have proven all those ill effects.
Well, there will always be, I think, those people who say, GMOs are perhaps the answer to some of the food problems that the world is facing in the years
that's
to come.
A myth.
There will be people who will be pro and anti GMO.
Yes.
But the fact is, if we agreed to allow GMOs to be planted, particularly BT mm-hmm. talong or BT eggplant, in the open, mm-hmm. There are some environmental and huge economic consequences and concerns here. It can't really be a case of, okay, fine, you want to do GMO? Go ahead and plant your GMO. We're going to plant our own GMO-free varieties over here. Fact is, they cannot coexist.
Coexist,
really.
Yeah. That is one of the major factors, because there will be gene flow from this plant to other. Mm-hmm. For these, even in the field trial, you had to tell to maintain a separation distance, and you had to maintain a refugee. That means a large amount of your agricultural land you have to sacrifice.
Right.
If it goes for commercialization, peasants are not going to obey these rules.
Right.
So the gene flow will occur. And when it goes into, when the through gene flow, it contaminates organic farmer, they cannot sell it even.
Right.
Because they had to say,
it cannot be organic anymore.
Whether
you want or not,
exactly.
Gene flow will happen and you will end up with a GMO crop. Okay. So
if there is only, even only 1% or less than 1% contamination, your whole cultivation will be sacrificed. They cannot coexist.
Okay, so this is an important thing that people who are concerned about the environment, people who are concerned about their health, people who are concerned about the food that they eat, should be looking into. The facts are out there. Go ahead, read up, educate yourself, and make a decision. But you know, legislation is going to be voted on, and we are going to be making a decision. So please read up, educate yourself, and make your voice heard. Tell the government what we want here. Thank you so much to Dr. Tushar Chakraborty for joining us this morning and helping shed some light on the subject.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. So do you have the next great green idea, or do you have any out-of-this-world plan to save the planet? Let us know. Tell us what you're doing to help save the environment. Send in your pictures and thoughts to ancsgoinggreen@gmail.com and get a chance to be featured right here where we are going green.
This segment was brought to you by Max by Revicon. How much do you love your wife?
Very Max.
Christmas is not just about gift giving and merrymaking.